Good morning and welcome to today's webinar. Today we're going to show you how to get started marketing a personal injury law practice online. Today's webinar is being recorded and will be available for replay online next week. We'll also make the slides available, so there's no need to take notes. We have a lot of ground to cover today, including three specialists who are going to talk about different aspects of getting started the right way. We've done a couple of these webinars in this series already with different practice areas, and this webinar today is scheduled to run for 2 hours. What we've experienced over the last couple webinars is that they typically run for somewhere a little bit longer than that. We've had one go about 2 hours and 15 minutes, and then one go about 2 hours and 20 minutes. We're not going to be able to stop to answer questions during the course of the presentation, but if you're having technical difficulty with the GoToWebinar audio or video, please let us know via the chat area of the GoToWebinar control panel. We will have a questions and answer session at the end of the presentation. So if you have questions along the way, please add them to the questions area of GoToWebinar, or send us a public or private chat message, and we'll make sure we address it at the end of the presentation. My name is Dan Jaffe. Before becoming the full-time CEO of Lawlytics, I built two successful law firms, first in Washington State and then in Arizona, and I also started a highly successful online legal directory that was later acquired by a large internet company. During my years in private practice, I made a lot of marketing investments, and I also made a lot of mistakes and got badly burned several times. During the course of that process, I realized that nobody cared about my practice like I did, and that in order to succeed, I needed to really understand how the internet works, and I needed to be in control of my marketing. I did the heavy lifting back then of figuring out how this stuff really works. And today I love showing fellow attorneys how it's done. We have a great program for you today. Each of our presenters is a specialist in her own area. I'm going to do an introduction for each of them now so that once we start this thing rolling, we can go from one presenter to the next without delay. Victoria Bloot comes from a journalism background and is the community manager here at Lawlytics. If you're a frequent reader of our blog, you're already familiar with her work. Victoria is going to talk about how your potential clients use the internet and how you can attract them and capture their business by understanding the basics of how the internet works. Rachel Shalott holds a JD and a master's and practiced law before joining Lawlytics. She is the vice president of content operations here at Lawlytics, which means that she's in charge of all of our content operations, which produces millions of written words for our members' websites and blogs each year. Rachel will discuss content strategies specific to starting a plaintiffs-based personal injury web presence. Sophia Oliboni holds a master's degree in web design and is a design specialist here at Lawlytics. When new members sign up for our service, she and her team help them choose their design preferences based on their goals. Today, Sophia is going to walk you through some of the things that all attorneys should know about website design. But before we get to our three presenters, I want to spend a bit of time on foundational items that attorneys oftentimes overlook when it comes to starting to market their personal injury law practice on the internet. The marketing of a personal injury law practice has changed in recent years, and it's continuing to evolve very rapidly. For attorneys who are willing to evolve with it, this presents an opportunity to make a lot of money and to expand into various different types of plaintiffs-based personal injury practice, as well as to conquer jurisdictions that they may not otherwise have been able to reach in the past. It also presents a way to get ahead of established attorneys who have been market leaders for years but have relied on old methods and aren't currently adapting. The internet has become the great equalizer. No longer is marketing success for personal injury lawyers simply a matter of budget plus the willingness to take financial risk. Now, any attorney who wants to can break into and have a thriving plaintiffs-based personal injury law practice with a minimum financial investment. And previously established attorneys are not safe in their market leader position, no matter how big their budget or how solidified their reputation seems to be. This webinar will show you how to lay the foundation to compete now and also for the foreseeable future. The things that we will discuss require you to expend some effort, or they require you to budget to pay somebody else to do those efforts for you. Done right, the outcome of either path is the same. Whichever path you choose for your firm, when you make the commitment to building the foundation for your personal injury firm the right way, and you understand the marketing strategy behind it, the time and money you spend on your marketing will not be wasted. What's great about the evolution of marketing for personal injury cases is that any attorney anywhere can get started easily and very cost effectively. And that's what this webinar is all about. And when you know how to avoid the traps and the tricks that too many lawyers seem to fall into while they're asleep at the marketing switch, and when you learn how to do a few simple things very well, there's a ton of money to be made. Today's webinar is the first in a series of three that will take you from just getting started marketing a plaintiffs-based personal injury practice online to market dominance. Today, we're going to cover the very basics. We hope that today's webinar will provide you with a solid understanding and the motivation to get started in the right direction, or if you've started before and it's simply not working anymore, to get restarted on the path to success. The next webinar in this series, which will happen next month, will focus on growing a personal injury practice. For that webinar, we're going to assume that you already understand the fundamentals that we're going over today, and that you have at least started to apply or think about applying them to your law firm's website and blog. That webinar will show you how the real money is made for most law firms. We'll take a much deeper dive into the forces that drive online success, including content and reputation management. And we'll give you a more detailed content roadmap to develop your plaintiffs-based personal injury marketing. The final webinar in this series, which happens in March, will focus on crossing the chasm between growing a thriving practice to having a dominant one in regards to your marketing. We have customers who are truly dominating in their practice areas and their markets, and I can tell you that each of them started out using the fundamentals that we're going to be going over today. The final webinar in this series in March will show you those extra 2 to 3% difference makers that you can then apply once you've gone through the start and the grow phase. And these 2 to 3% difference makers move the needle at scale, because we're talking about much larger numbers, but they're not things that you should be thinking about doing early on. If you're looking to take your personal injury marketing to the pinnacle of success, we recommend that you attend and watch all three of these, either live or on demand, and implement the recommendations that we're going to be talking about in chronological order. This webinar is for lawyers and staff members of law firms that are either currently handling plaintiff side contingency fee cases, as well as medical malpractice cases, or that plan to in the future. We've done other webinars that may be relevant, including mass tort series featuring Larry Bodine, for those that are interested in looking at mass torts as well. That webinar is not as foundational. It's more instructive about the nuances of getting started with a mass torts practice. But that's available online at our webinar, or at our website webinar section right now. And we're going to be doing other tort-specific mass torts webinars in the very near future. But back to this webinar, you don't need to be a Lawlytics member to benefit from what we're going to be talking about today. But everything that we will be covering will be easier for you to implement if you are a member, and a lot of our members are online as well, because the Lawlytics system and service is built and optimized for it. If you're just getting started with your website, this webinar is a great place to start. And if your website isn't working, it's likely because one or more of the fundamentals that we'll cover today have been ignored or have been poorly implemented. If you're here listening to this, it's probably because you want your website to work to bring in more personal injury clients who have viable claims and also to get more referrals for the types of cases that most plaintiffs-based attorneys want to have. But being here isn't enough. There aren't any participation trophies in the practice of law, and especially in the area of personal injury practice, it is highly competitive in most jurisdictions. So either you get your client's business or you don't get it and somebody else does. If you want to succeed, you'll need to commit to investing your time or to investing your money, and sometimes both. There are no shortcuts or magic tricks that will make you successful. And I really want to emphasize that when you're listening to this webinar and when you're thinking about all the things that you can do to get started, keep in mind that there are no magic tricks because a lot of attorneys fall for the illusion of magic when it comes down to simply hard work. So there's no magic tricks, but there is a roadmap. The goal of this session is simple. We want you to understand how to build your firm's online marketing for your personal injury practice using sound and sustainable strategies and to be able to use that foundation to effectively take your marketing to the next level and then to take it as high as you want it to go. We hope that what you learned today will help you capture more opportunities so that your success will open the door to even greater levels of marketing achievement and stability. By the time this webinar is over, we hope you'll have a good foundation to do the following. One, start smart. You only need to do a few things well from the beginning, as long as you avoid the tricks and the traps that are out there. Two, don't overcomplicate things. Building a thriving law firm web presence is easier than most attorneys think. And finally, your participation matters. Nobody cares about your practice as much as you do. You need to be involved and you need to be in control. This doesn't mean that you have to do everything or even anything yourself, but you need to know what needs to be done and why so that you can recognize value and avoid wasting your time and your money. The good news is that participation is easy and, in fact, it can actually be fun. This webinar is going to show you how. You have many choices of companies and technologies to design, build, host, and help you market your law firm's website. At Lawlytics, we do all of that, and we also have a lot of competition. So what is Lawlytics and how are we different? Our company is obsessed with the pursuit of the most efficient method of marketing for each law firm. As we see it, there are two major variables of efficiency, your time and your money. Lawlytics was created to empower law firms to have unlimited marketing success without wasting their time or their money. As we see it, we have two different types of competitors. On one side are full-service marketing companies, companies like FindLaw and Martin Del Nolo. Lawlytics is built to give attorneys all the upside of using a full-service company without exposing you to the risks and to the downside. On the other side are do-it-yourself website software programs like WordPress, Wix, and GoDaddy. These are cheap or free to use. These programs also come with a steep opportunity cost, and attorneys often struggle to make them work, wasting their time and missing opportunities and potential clients along the way. While both full-service companies and do-it-yourself platforms are viable options, and they're both generally accepted amongst lawyers, Lawlytics offers what we see as a more practical solution for law firms. Our company works exclusively with lawyers, and our services are adaptable to every stage of your law firm's growth. Our members can start as small as they choose, and then they can grow as big as they decide without taking dangerous risks or over committing to things that might not end up working. And our software was built exclusively for lawyers, so the learning curve is easy. And it enables our members to add to and edit their websites and turn their efforts into new business without struggling. Lawlytics is a membership-based law firm marketing service. Our software and service is specifically built for and optimized for you and your law firm's website. For those of you who are not yet Lawlytics members, here's how the process works. The first step is to have a conversation with us to make sure that there's alignment between the needs and goals of your firm and our services. Once you've decided that Lawlytics is the right fit for you, the next step is starting your firm's membership. We'll guide you through that simple process, which takes about 5 minutes. Then we start the process of setting up and styling your law firm's website. This is a collaborative process, and you'll work with one of our full-time professional designers one-on-one to achieve the optimal look and feel to meet your site's goals. The next step is adding content to your website. The goal of this phase is for you to have enough content to be able to successfully launch your law firm's website. If you already have a website that you want to import into Lawlytics, we have the process of transitioning from other platforms to Lawlytics down to a science. If you're starting a new website with Lawlytics, we'll guide you through the content that you need to launch. Rachel will talk later in this webinar about what content is needed to launch a personal injury website and how to build a strong foundation now so that you can prepare for future growth of that content and of your law firm's website. You can choose to create your own content, or you can have our team of professional writers do it for you. When the site is ready to launch, we're going to launch it for you. If you're switching from another provider, we'll make sure that there's no downtime or loss of traffic in that process. Whether you're switching to Lawlytics or starting fresh, we'll take care of all of the technical details for you. Once your site is launched, we'll show you how to use the Lawlytics system to add to and edit your website, regardless of your previous tech experience. We can take you from zero, from knowing nothing, to highly competent very quickly because our system was built for busy lawyers who simply don't have the time to mess around with complicated and unspecialized technology. You'll be able to instantly add and edit office locations, attorney bios, case results, recommendations, substantive pages, and blog posts. You'll be able to rearrange your site's menus simply by dragging and dropping pages around. You'll be able to create simple and detailed web forms to capture information from your potential clients. For example, you can do a detailed personal injury intake form right on your Lawlytics website. And you'll be able to easily insert pictures, videos, documents, and maps into the pages of your site. In short, you'll have the power to be as involved in your own website as you choose to be. And beyond the mechanics, we'll teach you how to implement a strategy that best suits the market that you're in, your practice areas, and the ambitions of your law firm. We'll show you what works and how to create it without wasting time or money. And even though you'll be able to do it all yourself, if you ever choose not to, you can delegate any or all of your efforts to us. You likely already have an understanding of the importance of having a website for your personal injury law practice, but I want to take a brief moment to look at the most important reasons why it's essential not just to have a website, but to invest in the kind of website that we'll be showing you how to build during this series. Keeping these reasons in mind will be just as important in the growth and the domination phases of your firm's marketing as they are in this start phase. Your personal injury clients are online, and they're using the internet to do research and to make decisions. Even when personal injury clients are referred directly to you, they will still interact with your web presence before making the decision to hire you. If you don't already have a website, you're at the mercy of everything else about you that exists online, and you have little or no control over those things. With a website, you have complete control over your messaging, and you have the opportunity to win the hearts and the minds of your potential clients. Your website is there to educate your potential clients about their case, their rights, and their options. is there to make a personal connection between you and your potential clients and to cause potential clients to like you and to want to hire you. The most important functions of your law firm's website are to, number one, above and beyond all else, to show that you care. Two, to show what you know, to show that you're an expert. And three, to show that you're successful. The proof that you're successful and have helped other people with injuries or other causes of actions like your potential clients have goes a long way towards solidifying their trust that you're going to be able to help them with a similar situation. All of these things set the tone for the attorney-client relationship because they establish trust, authority, and confidence. And when you have your potential client's trust and confidence, and when they see you as an authority before the attorney-client relationship even begins, your chances of them hiring you drastically increase. And the benefits go well beyond marketing and sales. Establishing trust, authority, and confidence helps frame the attorney-client relationship and set expectations. This ultimately makes the experience easier and more rewarding for both you and your clients. As we present this, it's January 2017. If you're just getting started with your law firm's website, you're already very late to the game. But that's okay, because for better or worse, most attorneys who have been in this game for many years have not been playing it well because they've been listening to the wrong people or they've been doing the wrong things. Website marketing for personal injury cases works. And it can work better than any other source of business when it's done well. So while everybody seems to be doing it, the fact that most attorneys don't have websites that are performing to their full potential is an opportunity for you and your personal injury practice. Having a website is a matter of basic business survival for lawyers, but having a website that you consciously cultivate using the Lawlytics system and the information that you'll get in this webinar series and from other Lawlytics webinars can elevate your practice by multitudes. We see attorneys who were struggling to stay in business start using Lawlytics, start following our system, using our technology, and become secure and stable in their practices. And we've seen attorneys who thought they were doing very well start using Lawlytics and literally double their revenue while actually decreasing their marketing expenses. There's no magic trick here. There's a proven method and there's a window of opportunity. Creating a worthwhile website for your law firm is like investing with compounding interest. The earlier you start, the better off you'll be in the long run. And like sound investing, there's no need to do anything fancy here. You don't need tricks, you don't need cheats, you don't need hacks. All you need is an understanding of the fundamentals and the technology and the time to leverage the fundamentals effectively over time. I have two more slides left and then we'll get on to the substance of Victoria, who's going to talk about the meat and potatoes of SEO. But before we do so, here at Lawlytics, we use the phrase marketing assets regularly. I want to take a moment to explain what we mean by marketing assets and why it's important. Most marketing that you do for your law firm falls into the category of an expense. The nature of most advertising is that you buy it, it gets used up, and then it's gone forever. Let's look at some examples of marketing that falls into the expense category. Yellow page advertising is an expense. You pay for the year and then people throw the book away and it's no longer useful. Same with billboard advertising. Once the time that you paid for is done, the billboard comes down. Same with radio and TV advertising. But these are the clear-cut examples. Online, it's not always so obvious. When you rent a directory listing, for example, or a sponsored listing or a premium spot on a legal directory, you're renting disposable advertising, and this is an expense. If you don't renew and continue to pay, it simply goes away. Pay-per-click advertising is also an expense. You make a bid, and in personal injury law in particular, those bids can be very high. We've seen personal injury terms that are upwards of $200. We've seen medical malpractice terms that are in that same range. So you make a bid, and a customer of the search engine clicks on that ad, and that $200, each click is gone forever. Same thing with banner ads, remarketing ads, online magazine ads, social media ads, etc. But content placed on your website that you own is a marketing asset, because once that content is produced, it can continue to produce business for you and your firm indefinitely. Think of it like owning a building in a prime location with a great sign. Once that building is owned and the sign is paid off, each additional impression that it makes on passersby costs you nothing, well, aside from the building maintenance expenses. With content, you invest your efforts or you invest your dollars once, and if the content is well written, your potential clients will interact with it for years to come. With Lawlytics, you own your own website and you own your own content, and we're here to help you by strategically maintaining and providing your infrastructure and giving you guidance and support and upgrading your technology along the way. It's important to note that just because you create content online doesn't always mean that you own it. For example, if you're writing answers for a legal directory or a forum that you don't own, you're investing in creating assets for the company that does own that directory or that forum. And that company is likely ultimately in business to make money. And to benefit from those assets ultimately, they're likely to ask you to pay. If not now, then sometime in the future. And if you don't pay, your efforts and your name will likely serve to attract your potential clients to your competitors who are willing to pay for ads that are supported by your previous content creation efforts. This is a topic that could fill more than a two-hour webinar in and of itself. And if you want to go deeper into it, Google commoditization of lawyers and read a piece that I wrote about 2 years on the subject, 2 years ago rather, on the subject. It's every bit as relevant today, if not more so, than it was 2 years ago. Because here at Lawlytics, we're obsessed with helping lawyers find the most efficient ways of marketing their firms online. And because we're sticklers about not letting attorneys waste their time or their money, it bears repeating that everything that Lawlytics does and helps you do is geared towards creating appreciating marketing assets that you own and control. In a few moments, Tori, Rachel, and Sophia will talk with you about various aspects of the appreciating asset, that is your law firm's website. Before I turn the floor over to Victoria, I have one final slide, and I want to spend a few moments talking about content. So what is content marketing, and why should lawyers be doing it? Most lawyers think that they need a thing called SEO, which stands for search engine optimization. It's about making it easy for potential clients to find your law firm through free search engine results. Content marketing is the most important ingredient of SEO. And without enough high-quality content, no other aspect of SEO will ever be effective for your law firm. Think about it this way. When you sit across the desk from a potential personal injury client, or you're visiting them in the hospital, or you're visiting with the family members of a decedent, you're engaged in a conversation. You're engaged in a discovery process. You're evaluating the potential client's case and the ability to ultimately recover damages. And your potential client, in turn, is evaluating your ability to help him or her or their loved ones. But you're also engaged in marketing during this conversation. And everything that you say about your firm and yourself and their case in general guides their perception of you and your firm. Everything that they see in your office, from your reception area to your conference table, to the degrees that you have on your walls, to the books on your shelf, to the way that even you offer them coffee, all of these things create a story of who you are in their minds and whether they want to do business with you and your firm. Content marketing is about preloading your potential clients' perceptions about you and your firm. The information that you would normally provide them at a first meeting, if you can take that information and you can put it on your website, the more you can do this, the better. And here's why. Your potential personal injury clients are searching for answers online as much as they're searching for an attorney. When you provide them with complete and helpful answers as opposed to keyword-based nonsense that a lot of SEO people do or self-serving marketing copy, in other words, this law firm is so great because we practice personal injury law and we're the best personal injury lawyers around, stuff like that. When you provide them with answers to their questions, something very efficient happens. The first thing that happens is search engines give it preference. Your clients will then find it based on questions that they are asking the search engines. When they find it and read it, they'll instantly know that you know, they'll know that you care, and they'll suspect that you're successful because you have a lot of information about that on your website, and then you can provide them concrete examples on your website showing that you are successful in cases just like theirs. The net effect of this is that they end up trusting you before you even speak with them because you've already helped them by giving them that information. And they become more likely to hire you at that point. And when they do hire you, they become easier to manage because their expectations and the information that you already want them to have is already in place and well aligned with you and your firm. In the next two segments of this webinar, Victoria and Rachel are going to go into greater detail about the basics of getting started on the right track with high-quality content for your personal injury practice. And with that, I'd like to turn the microphone over to Victoria, who's going to talk about the basics of the search engines and how to start building your personal injury web presence the right way. Tori?
Hey, Dan. Good morning. Can you hear me?
I can.
Perfect. Good morning and good afternoon to those of you who are on the East Coast. For those of you who aren't familiar with me, my name is Victoria Blute and I'm the community manager of Lawlytics. My job is to keep attorneys on the cutting edge of web technologies and online legal marketing and help you learn about what works on the web. So now that Dan has discussed a little bit about the foundational aspects of marketing your personal injury practice, I'm going to explain to you how your potential clients use the internet and also how they don't use the internet. We'll talk about how to recognize some of the myths that go along with online legal marketing and what you need to attract potential clients to your firm. And a lot of that starts with understanding some terminology and how the internet works. The first slide I want to discuss will set the tone for a lot of what I'm going to be talking about. And it's important whether or not you're familiar with this term. If you are, you may want to check your assumptions about what you think this term means, and that term is SEO. So as Dan said, SEO stands for Search Engine Optimization. And while I've heard it described a number of ways, I think the best way to describe SEO is to say that it's the process of growing your website's visibility in organic search engine results. In other words, helping more potential clients find you on search engines. For those of you who are familiar with this term and with this idea, this may seem like a rather obvious sort of description, and I may end up discussing some topics that seem quite basic, but I think it's important to bring up because attorneys sometimes get caught in the trap of understanding what SEO is as it's defined here, but may make some mistakes in how that process is carried out. So if you have some preconceived notions about how this works, check your assumptions. See if what you believe makes sense here as well, and if this is all new to you and you're starting with a blank slate, that's great too. So let's first talk about how search engines work, and then let's talk about how your potential clients are using search engines to find you. So search engines work by finding, gathering, and displaying relevant information to those who are searching for it. When Google started as a company, their founders said that they wanted to organize all of the world's information. That's how we got here. There are three basic steps here that search engines go through, and if you hear me say Google a lot instead of just search engines in general, know that the process is similar for all search engines, but I say Google because that's the most popular search engine. People certainly do use Bing and they use Yahoo search, but there is a reason Google is also a verb, as in to Google, and that's because it's the best and most popular method for finding information. Okay, so step one is crawling. You'll hear other terms for crawling. You'll hear people talk about Google's spiders, bots, crawlers, whatever you want to call it. Google has these bots that are busy crawling the web. And what I mean when I say crawling is that these robots are following links from page to page to see what's there. Google then sorts those pages by the content that's featured on them and some other factors. Once Google finds a web page and figures out what's on there, it then adds that page to its massive index. And Google does this so that it can quickly access that information again when a search engine user makes a relevant search. The last step is retrieval, and that's what all the crawling and the indexing is for in the first place. At this point, Google gets a query and quickly decides what is most relevant. Then it pulls that information from its index and delivers those pages as search engine results. For example, if someone searches for what should I do if I was in a car wreck on a California highway, or I was injured by a drunk driver in Los Angeles, do I need an attorney? Google will search through its index looking for the most relevant answer to that question. Now, how Google makes a decision about what results are the most relevant is to some degree shrouded in mystery. There are hundreds of different factors in that decision, and they all hold different weight, and Google doesn't tell us about what those are exactly. But the company has famously said that they want you to make websites for people, not for search engines. So if you're going to make a website for a person and not for a search engine, how do you do that exactly? And what that requires is an understanding of how people, or in this case your potential clients, actually use search engines. This is an area where there can be a little bit of a disconnect for attorneys, but when you really understand how this works and you're able to put it into action, your marketing can really take off. So let's talk about how your potential clients use search engines to find you. Okay, let's start with a hypothetical scenario. For a moment, I want you to imagine that you are a potential client for your personal injury practice. In your mind, map the route that your potential client takes from needing an attorney to finding your law firm's website and contacting you. What does that look like? What I'm going to give you next is an example of what we hear a lot from attorneys, and we'll use personal injury attorneys as an example here. Does that route look something like this? My potential client opens their laptop, they go to Google, and then because they need a personal injury attorney in Austin, Texas, they conduct a search for personal injury attorney Austin. They find my website because I'm a personal injury attorney in Austin, and then they contact my law firm. Is your answer something like this one? If it is, this is a common misunderstanding that some personal injury attorneys have when they think about how potential clients search for them online. They assume that the path to marketing themselves successfully online works in this way, but when they think that it works this way, they end up frustrated and spending a lot of time and money on things that they don't need. So, to do your marketing efficiently and cost-effectively online, there is one major component that you need that Dan talked about, and that is this: content. So the very shortest answer to explain what SEO is really about and how to attract potential clients to your personal injury website is that your website needs content, and we're going to talk about content in depth. But to really understand why content is the answer, we have to understand why that hypothetical scenario that we just talked about doesn't make any sense. So in that example, we have three possible assumptions. The first is that your potential clients usually know that they need a personal injury attorney before they conduct a search. The second is that your potential clients usually search for personal injury attorneys directly. And the third is that potential clients usually conduct basic keyword searches to find a personal injury attorney. There's a fourth assumption here, and that's that your potential client is using a laptop rather than a mobile device. Mobile-friendly sites are something that we'll discuss later on, but let's look at each of those assumptions and why that's not how clients use search engines, and also how content is the right online marketing solution here. So the first assumption we said is that potential clients usually know that they need a personal injury attorney before they conduct a search, and that is not always the case. What potential clients often know is that they have a problem and they're not sure how to solve it. They may open their laptop and go to Google. That much is true. The next part is that they'll probably conduct a question-based search. So instead of searches like personal injury attorney or San Antonio auto wreck lawyer, a potential client may ask a question more like what we discussed earlier. So like, what should I do if I was in a car wreck on a California highway, or I was injured by another driver in Phoenix, do I need an attorney? Some potential clients may suspect that they need a personal injury attorney, but they may still do research about how their current problem could affect them. If it's a matter of a device that's injured them, they may ask questions about why their knee or hip replacement has failed early and is causing them pain, or asking about a defective device or car part or a medication that they wonder may be causing them problems. A family member may do research on options for a loved one who was hit by a car on a crosswalk or hit while riding their bicycle. And the thing that links their questions and the results that Google returns and your personal injury firm is content. When Google is asked a question by somebody, Google's main focus is to return the most relevant results for the person who made that search. This is what Google is talking about when they say to make websites for people and not for search engines. People need answers and Google wants to provide them. And they want to provide the best content they can offer to their users. It's the entire basis of their business model. Google is the dominant search engine because they do provide the best answers of any search engine. And if your website is providing insightful content that answers the questions that your potential clients are asking, that's not only how you increase your visibility, but also your ability to actually connect with those potential clients and to build your personal injury practice. Okay, so the second assumption is that potential clients usually search for attorneys directly. Again, this is not always true. Potential clients don't always search for attorneys directly, and this is a flawed assumption because it assumes that potential clients search for an attorney in the same way that somebody might search for a t-shirt brand at a local store. As an example of this, somebody might search for Hanes T-shirts, Target San Diego. And the reason they're doing that might be to see if a local Target has this shirt brand in stock. But we have to keep in mind that a T-shirt is a consumer product. That person who's conducting that search likely knows roughly what they want and where they want to buy it. That's a very easy decision. Choosing a personal injury attorney is an important process, it's a complex process, and it's one that has real effects for the potential client. And despite the attempted commoditization of attorneys by the legal marketing industry, attorneys are not consumer products, and potential clients don't search for attorneys in the same way that they might for a shirt. The third assumption is that potential clients usually conduct basic keyword searches to find an attorney. In that hypothetical example we had, the basic keyword search was for personal injury attorney Austin. Consider the basic keyword search for Hanes T-shirts Target. So this example assumes that a person will conduct a vague search. Maybe this person just wants to see if Target carries Hanes T-shirts. But if that person already knows what they want, they are much more likely to conduct a highly specific search. Think about the different results you get by searching for Hanes T-shirts Target versus Hanes men's V-neck white t-shirt size XL Target San Diego. So the first search will bring you a lot of different results about a lot of different shirts, right? The second will very quickly tell you whether that store has exactly what you're looking for. people do not want to sift through results. They want an immediate answer, and in the age that we live in now, they've come to expect it. The same goes for your potential clients when they ask questions of Google. So they're not likely to search for California personal injury attorney or car wreck lawyer and then scan through hundreds and hundreds of results. They have a question about their problem and they want an answer to that problem. When potential clients ask specific questions, Google will attempt to provide them with very specific results. When you answer those questions with quality content on your firm's website and blog, you become much more likely to be found in search results because your content closely matches the question that your potential client has. And by giving them that information that they need, you're much more likely to create a bond of trust that encourages them to contact your law firm. So here's an example of how law firm SEO actually works for attorneys. Let's say we have a potential client who conducts a Google search like, what can you do if someone hits your car in an accident but they don't have insurance? Or a UPS driver crashed into a car that crashed into me, what are my rights? In this case, let's say that you've written a blog post about this topic with lots of useful information. You've written the blog post in language that the potential client uses, and that makes it easy for them to understand and connect with. At this point, your potential client reads what you have to say, and it's helped them to answer their question. And now that they're visiting your law firm's blog, they look around and they read some other content that you've written as well. And when what you've written is helpful, when it's informative, your potential client begins to build that bond of trust with you. Your content demonstrates that you understand their problem and that you know what the potential client should do. At this point, they reach out to you when they want more information or they're ready to hire you. This is an example of how your potential clients actually use search engines and how they're likely to connect with you online. There's one point I want to make very quickly, and that is this. So, I know that earlier I said that your potential clients don't usually type in basic keywords. Let me first say that words like car wreck attorney or personal injury attorney are keywords related to your practice, but to try to compete for a rank with those words alone can just be astronomically difficult, both in organic search and if you choose to do pay-per-click advertising, that can become very expensive very quickly. Legal terms are among the most expensive and sought after. So how can a small law firm rank for terms like personal injury attorney? And the answer to that is by adding it to a long tail keyword and using those long tail keywords in specific places on law firm websites and blogs. So here's a quick doodle that I did that explains why long tail keywords are effective for personal injury firms. Long tail keywords are those that are incorporated into a more complex question or phrase that really narrows the window and creates a more specific search. And this is really how many people search online. What this diagram illustrates is the value in going after long tail keywords, and I'll explain it to you here. So on the y-axis, we have the degree of competition and cost for a keyword. So the higher on the y-axis, the higher the cost and the higher the competition for such a keyword. On the x-axis, we have the likelihood that a potential client converts, or in this case, contacts your firm. And the further left you are, the less likely an individual is to contact you. Let's look at a single word phrase, like attorney, like you see in green here. That is a very, very non-specific keyword for which there's a lot of competition, not a lot of likelihood for conversion. Nobody in their right mind types in the word attorney and then scrolls through hundreds of pages of results. If we get slightly more specific with personal injury attorney or San Antonio car wreck lawyer, as you see in orange, these are more specific than attorney, but these are still highly sought after terms, and there may be only slightly more likely to convert somebody who searches for it. And as we said before, potential clients usually don't search in this way. If we look at the part in blue here we have some highly descriptive, specific phrases, the kinds of questions that your potential clients are likely to ask. These ones have a much higher likelihood of converting people because they directly address the kinds of questions that potential clients ask. There is far less competition for these terms, and there are millions of long-tail keyword phrases that you can target. With so much competition for some popular keywords, it is nearly impossible for a new law firm website to rank organically for those very popular terms. And if you pay to compete for those terms through disposable advertising like pay-per-click, you may end up paying a lot of money to compete for web visitors who may or may not click on your ads and may or may not be potential clients for your firm. Remember that with pay-per-click, once somebody has clicked on that ad, whether they are a potential client, whether it's an accidental click, whether it's your competition, the money is gone once it's gone. Attorneys need to also consider that your potential clients have ad blindness. People are so used to being bombarded with messages every single day that they don't even see a lot of them anymore. Additionally, ad blockers have made it easier than ever for people to ignore ads, even outside of regular ad blindness. And that's a new element that's been added to the mix, in that you may well be trying to advertise to people who will never even see your ads. Now, I'm sure there are some of you who have this question, and that is, can I only compete for long-tail keywords? And the answer to that is no. There are small law firms that rank very well for popular law firm keywords, ones like personal injury attorney. But how they got there is often a byproduct of publishing a lot of original, useful content that's related to those terms. And that content is likely in the form of long-tail keywords and phrases. For example, a small law firm may not be able to compete for a term like personal injury attorney San Antonio, but that attorney can compete for related searches when they write a significant volume of content that addresses questions like, a UPS driver in San Antonio crashed into a car that crashed into me, what are my rights, or should I get an attorney? When you not only optimize for that extremely specific phrase here, you also end up optimizing for the basic attorney-related term that that phrase contains. And I should also mention here that one of the major things that Google is working on right now with algorithms like RankBrain and some others is the artificial intelligence aspect of search, particularly understanding user intent. So when that potential client makes a search like this one, Google is trying to understand if this person may be looking for a personal injury attorney. Okay. So now that we've talked about how all of this actually works, let's talk a little bit about some SEO-related myths, because this is a place where attorneys often get tripped up, and they don't have to. Now that you understand a little bit more about how the internet works and how your potential clients use search engines, the reasons why these myths don't make sense and can cost your firm a lot of wasted time and wasted money, I think will start to make a lot of sense to you. The first myth that I want to address is what happens when somebody promises that they can provide you with quick results, and by that I mean somebody telling you that you can rank for an incredibly popular keyword in just a few weeks, these kinds of promises. Even the very best law firm SEO strategist has no control over what Google or any other search engine does. And building up your content does take some time. It's not a one and done magical sort of process, and it's something you're always going to be working on and continually adding to. So if somebody tells you that they can get your law firm to the top of Google in 3 weeks, there's just no way. And that brings me to my next point, and that's the promise of the quote-unquote top of Google. There is no such thing. What these two things have in common with each other is that they're related to the myth of overnight success. So for any Google search that you make, there's a number one ranking position. We know that. But there's no top of Google. If you search for a basic keyword phrase like personal injury attorney Los Angeles, the results that you'll receive are different based on the day that you search, on the location that you search from, the browser that you're using, the device that you're searching on, among other factors. Just about the only thing that will be the same about each search that your potential clients do for a basic keyword search like that is that they're all going to be different. If we assume that potential clients search for basic keyword phrases like the one we just discussed, then we're also assuming that they know that they need an attorney and search exactly for those terms, and as we know now, that's not always the case. Potential clients often search by asking Google questions about their case or their problem, and those questions may include basic keyword terms like we saw in long-tail searches. But those basic terms are often nestled into those long tail phrases, and a majority of daily searches are completely unique. People ask new questions all the time. And for each unique search, Google is going to give a unique set of search results. The next myth is that SEO for personal injury attorneys is complicated or that you don't have the time to learn, and that, of course, is untrue. You are going to learn a large part of what you need to know today just by sitting here. And as you can see, what's more complicated than writing content is trying to struggle with methods and tactics that don't work and that are based on false assumptions. That is far more complicated than taking the time to know what works from the beginning and then building a solid foundation on that. Next up is the special relationship with Google. This is one that comes up every once in a while, whether somebody is cold calling your firm to tell you that they have a special relationship with Google and that they can get you to the top of Google in a week, or that they know something special about a Google algorithm update. All of this is nonsense. Now, marketers can be Google partners. They can resell Google products like PPC ads or Google apps, but none of those things are going to help you as a personal injury attorney with your SEO. Lastly is that there is a secret to ranking well. So, as I said earlier, Google's ranking factors and their relative weights are a secret. What's not a secret, and it never has been, is that Google wants you to write a lot of quality content for your website so that they can provide it to people who are making related queries. They want to be able to provide the best content, and that is what they're looking for. So when you do write useful, insightful content that helps your potential clients, and you do that on a regular basis, Google is paying attention to that and can reward you with better placement in search engine results. The only secrets that there might be here is that content is really the key, and if you're not writing it, your competitors are going to. Here are some other common myths that are old. They date back to the early days of the search engines, but they're persistent, so I thought it was useful to bring them up. The first is keyword meta tags. So early on, keyword meta tags were actually an important process, or important part of the SEO process. And for those of you who don't remember this, what you'd do is you'd include the keyword meta tags that you wanted your site to rank for, and those pages would come up in results for relevant queries. But unfortunately, this process was quickly used and abused by spammers, so much so that it got dropped as an important signal because it frustrated users who were looking for actual information. And that, of course, is in direct conflict with what Google is trying to do. They don't have a business if they can't provide people with the best search results for the questions that they have. So it's why they've worked so hard on algorithm updates to ensure that people who are trying to cheat or game the system can't do so. More web pages being equal to a better ranking. So not only is this myth untrue, it can also harm your law firm's web presence. More pages are not equivalent, or not always equivalent, I should say, to a better search engine ranking. There are large law firm websites that rank well within the search engines, and those law firm websites do have thousands and thousands of pages. But the key difference here is that those pages are filled with useful content for potential clients, and they've been built up with that quality content over time. These pages were not hastily assembled. They were carefully crafted to provide potential clients with the information that's the most important to them. A website can be large in terms of the number of pages that it has, but simply adding pages without good content to support them can be a real recipe for trouble. Publishing lots of pages without the quality content necessary to make those pages valuable to web users is really unlikely to bring your law firm better rankings. In fact, it can even hurt your law firm's website rankings. I pulled a little quote from Google's Webmaster Guidelines, which I absolutely recommend that all attorneys go and read. The quote is this. It says, "One of the most important steps in improving your site's ranking in Google search results is to ensure that it contains plenty of rich information that includes relevant keywords used appropriately that indicate the subject matter of your content. However, some webmasters attempt to improve their page's ranking and attract visitors by creating pages with many words but little or no authentic content. Google will take action against domains that try to rank more highly just by showing scraped or other cookie-cutter pages that don't add substantial value to users." So, again, I do recommend that all attorneys go check out Google's Webmaster Guidelines. As they say, inclusion in Google is a privilege and not a right, so it's really important to stay on the right side of that. Next up is overvaluing keywords and keyword stuffing. So this is a very persistent myth that causes attorneys to struggle. So whether it's a matter of obsessing over the top keywords or stuffing keywords into your web pages, this is another thing that can damage your web presence. And for those of you who are not familiar, keyword stuffing has to do with the myth of keyword density. People think that how many times a keyword shows up on a page has everything to do with how search engines determine relevancy and ranking, and it's simply not true. This is one of those myths that has been proven over and over again not to be true, but there are still SEO providers who will push this. Okay, last one, that spending money on pay-per-click advertising helps your organic results. And this is unlikely to be true. In fact, search engines have done work to ensure this doesn't happen. There is no special access or consideration provided by search engines for those who spend money, or as it often happens in this case, more and more money on paid search. Okay, so we've covered a lot of the big myths that surround online legal marketing. Let's go back to the big thing that your website needs, and that is content. Attorneys, whether they know it or not, have a content problem that's illustrated by this little diagram here. And to do successful online marketing, an intrinsic part of that, of engaging potential clients and getting business online, is content. You need content, you likely need lots of it. And if you haven't been to our website, we have a number of free on-demand webinars that carefully detail what you need to do to plan your content, to blog, to write for the web, so feel free to check those out. But the point here is that you need content and you're going to have to make some decisions about that. So if you want to write your own content, that's fantastic, and at Lawlytics we can show you how to write it the right way in a way that will attract your potential clients. So if you want to write it, that's great. Now, if you're not going to write it, that puts you in one of two positions. Either you've got to delegate it to somebody else, and it's important here that you delegate it the right way to someone who understands what you do as a personal injury attorney. If you do that, you'll be in good shape. The alternative is that you don't delegate, and the longer you wait to do that and the longer you wait to write, the longer that you wait to engage your potential clients who are looking for you online, the more time you're wasting and the more opportunities that you're missing. And your competitors will be getting ahead writing the content that you are not. So we really see it as axiomatic that you need content. It really just comes down to deciding who is going to write it. In the content that you'll write, an underlying goal of that should be to compel your potential clients to reach out to you. And the way to do that isn't simply to say, call my personal injury firm now, but it's to connect to them through your writing. Your content should inspire confidence in them that you know what you're talking about and that you're the right personal injury attorney to assist them with their problem, that they can trust you. People who seek personal injury attorneys may be in pain, they may be frustrated or frightened, and your potential client needs to know that if they choose you, they can really trust you to work and work for them and fight for the best possible outcome. And you're also trying to convey sameness, so your potential clients aren't just looking for an attorney. They need a human who also practices the law and really understands their problem and gets where they're coming from and has empathy for their situation. So here's what your content should do. It should show your potential clients that you know what you're talking about, so establishing subject matter expertise. And you can do that in both your website substantive content and also in blog posts, and we're going to talk about that more in just a minute. But make sure that you do it in a way that a layperson can understand. Keep in mind that your potential clients may not come from a legal background, and you're familiar with the terms of art of the law, and they likely are not, and legalese can really be confusing or frustrating. Show them that you're passionate and interested in them and their problems. So part of that is publishing new content on a regular basis. Nothing says I'm not interested in what I do like a blog that's been abandoned or a website that doesn't have new content that's published quite often. And they also need to understand that the problem that they're facing is complex, but it's one that you're uniquely suited to help them solve. content can show up in a lot of different forms, and these are the basic structural elements that you'll feature on your website. The text, of course, is the most basic part of your website, and before you start delving into the bells and whistles like video and audio, I stress that it is very important to have a strong, well-established foundation of text content. Once that is established, then you can start thinking about enhancements like infographics and video, which do add to your web presence and can be helpful educational tools for your potential clients, but that written content foundation has really got to come first. So there are three basic kinds of content. There is blog content, there's substantive content, also sometimes referred to as evergreen content, and reputational content. And each of these are different from each other and serve different purposes, so we're going to discuss why that is and why you need to develop each of these. And let's start with blog content. So, substantive content is the meat of your website. This is also sometimes referred to as evergreen content. It's the content that remains consistent and consistently relevant for your readership. We're going to talk about that more in just a minute. First, let's talk about blogging. So, whether the idea of blogging for your law firm is completely new to you, or you know that you need to and you haven't gotten around to it yet, blogging is one of the most efficient and effective ways to market your firm for a number of reasons. A blog for your personal injury practice helps your firm stay relevant. Many potential clients use the web to find their attorneys, and a lack of participation online can raise some red flags for potential clients. They expect to find you online, they expect to find that you're participating in the online discussion. Blogging on a regular basis allows you to consistently connect with potential clients while creating discourse about a variety of topics. It helps to answer the questions that your potential clients have, and as I said earlier, it helps to build that bond of trust. If you're an attorney who is worried about traffic, worried about rankings, search engine optimization, you are not alone. A lot of attorneys are. One question that we often get here at Lawlytics from those attorneys is the question of, my SEO strategy doesn't seem to be working, how can I improve my traffic and rankings? And a follow-up question that we often ask is, how often are you blogging? When SEO strategy isn't working, what it can often be attributed to is a lack of blogging, whether that is infrequent blogging or no blogging at all. By writing blogs on a regular basis, you can improve your traffic. The more quality content that you write, the more opportunities Google Spider see to come back to your website and index that new material for the relevant queries of potential clients. They're always looking for new material. Blogging also makes you and your firm unique. It helps to build relationships with potential clients. It sets you apart from lawyers who aren't blogging at all, but above all that, it's a place to show your potential clients that you care about the questions that they're asking and that you're devoting individual blog posts to answering those questions. It also gives you a space to give your opinion, to make commentary, and to keep people returning to your website. Here is another thing that attorneys will want to consider about blogging. With an increasing number of small firms being eaten up by larger firms, you'll want a way to make sure that your presence is unique and priceless even in the face of a merger, and that's really where thought leadership comes in. Blogging isn't just an appreciating asset for your law firm, it's an asset for you personally. If it comes time to trim the fat when a merger happens, a larger firm may not cut an individual who has amassed a large following with a blog. Blogs establish you as a thought leader, someone who's an authority in their field, someone who is uniquely influential. Because blogs are highly effective in connecting with potential clients and turning them into your clients, a blog is a major asset for your law firm, for you, for your financial security, and for your future. So now that you know a little bit more about blogging, keep in mind that at the Lawlytics website, we have a lot of free resources for you to look at if you need blog topic inspiration or you're ready to start thinking about content planning, and we'll revisit this a little bit later as well. So, substantive content. This is, as I said, the meat of your website, and also sometimes referred to as evergreen content. It's the content that stays consistent and that is consistently relevant for your readership for a long time. Here are some of the areas that constitute substantive pages, and they can really be divided into two categories. The first is the pages that are about you, so about your firm, your attorney bio or bios if you have more than one attorney, your office location or locations plural, recommendations from happy former clients, and other things like case results that demonstrate your capability. The second category is the pages that are about your potential clients and about the problem or the case that they're facing. And that includes practice area pages, the pages that detail important aspects about the law in the place where you live, local pages that help you strategically target your specific local audience, FAQ pages with things or that help with things like client expectation management and case studies. So let's start with this topic about your firm. A lot of times we see about your firm pages that are very conservative and maybe just a series of facts about the firm. But that's not very engaging. So think about how on your firm's page, and this is aside from the individual bio pages, how are you going to refer to yourself? Are you going to talk about yourself in the first person? Are you going to choose a third-person approach? And there are benefits and drawbacks to each. I wrote a blog post about this in mid-November about when you may want to choose first, second, or third person. So feel free to check that out at the Lawlytics blog if you need some help deciding or you're just sort of curious about the various considerations. But as you're writing this page, ask yourself if this really sets you apart from other personal injury attorneys and from other firms. What makes your firm unique? What is your unique selling proposition or USP? Does it get to the heart of who you are? Does it let your audience get to know you? And that takes us to a related page, which is your attorney bio. So attorney bios are historically one of the most visited and most important pages on your site. And they can really be a powerful business generator, but only when they're written the right way. This requires some thought. One thing that often happens with attorney bios is that attorneys are tempted to rattle off long lists of facts about their educational history, their accolades, their awards, so on and so forth. And there's a place to talk about that and a way to do that. But the trick with attorney bios is not to talk about your accomplishments in the way that you might to another attorney, but to think about this in the context of what it means to your potential client. So let's take a look at what your potential client cares about. So it's very important to understand how your potential clients and referral sources approach the information that they are consuming about you. Before your potential client or referral sources consider things like your accomplishments, your educational history, they want to know about you as a person. There's that saying that says that people don't care about what you know until they know how much you care, and here this is very fitting. Aside from knowing how much you care about what you do, your potential clients also want to know how enthusiastic you are, how intense is your interest in your practice, in them, in their problem. Once they know that you care about them and that you care about what you do, then they want to know about what you've done. So here's a way to think about this. First, write about your journey to the law. You need to show your potential clients that you care about them, that you care about their case and your practice. So consider trying to answer the following questions. How did you get to where you are right now? Why is it that you chose to handle the cases that you do, the types of cases that your potential client is wondering if you can help them with? What inspired you to become a lawyer? What inspired your career path? What happened during your formative years to make you decide that you wanted to practice the law? Second, what motivates you as an attorney and as a person? And the deeper that you can dig for things that motivate you outside of just winning or making money, the more you can make it about your potential client and about your success being dependent on the valuable benefit that you provide to your potential clients, the more relatable that you make yourself to the people that are wondering if you can help them. And it's about things like getting a client through a difficult situation with peace of mind. So ask yourself, what drives you to do it and what inspires you? Third, who do you surround yourself with? Potential clients want to know who you surround yourself with, and not just in the law, though that's important too, but also in your life. So what kind of extracurricular activities are you a part of? Do you support some kind of youth group? Are you a member of charities? What do you do for the community? What helps define you, define yourself outside of the law? People will often read more into who you are based on the company that you keep more than anything else that you say on your bio. Number four, who have you helped? So Lawlytics does provide a special module for doing attorney bios and a separate module for case results, but we also provide a special module for recommendations from your clients and from your peers. That's not what we're talking about here. Your attorney bio isn't a place to discuss individual cases, but instead to discuss cases more generally. Think about the type of person that you typically help. You want to paint a picture of who you've helped and why you enjoy doing that. Number five, what have you done? So talk about what you've accomplished in your law career and education. What qualifies you? And here, this can be your honors, case results, publications. The problem here is that attorneys tend to just list these things. So instead of just listing those, talk about what it means to you. Take a publication, for example. Talk about what it means to you to have been selected, how the process works, why it's a big deal. Give it some context. For example, so maybe you've been selected as a top lawyer in your area by a local magazine. What went into the selection process? What was the criteria? How do they define it? And what does that mean to you? Keep in mind that, again, what may be obvious to you is not necessarily obvious to your potential client, especially if they don't have a legal background. The reality is that many potential clients don't understand what the various terms of art attorneys use to compare themselves to one another really mean. So if you're AV rated, good to explain what that means. If you have a perfect score of 10 on AVO, what does that mean? What have you done to earn that? How many clients have you helped? What do you typically do during that process? And this is not an exhaustive list, but the more of these things that you think about and write about in your attorney bio, the more ideas you'll have for other things to talk about. Office location. So an office location page sounds simple, and they can be, but they can be much more than just an address and a phone number. Your potential clients obviously need to know your address and phone number, but give them some extra information that they need. They need maps. They need to know if you have multiple locations. Maybe you have different attorneys at each location. They need to know that too. They need to know who to expect when they go to a location. Then consider adding some relevant facts. How do you get there? Do they need their parking validated? Are there certain landmarks that they should be looking for? Is your office on a side street that's hard to find? And be sure to add pictures too. It makes things much more comfortable for your potential clients. And as you create this content, you make an impression on your potential client that you care about making it as easy as possible for them to find you and to get what they need. Recommendations. So recommendations are a very important point of proof, and there's no better way to prove to your potential clients and your referral sources that you can do a good job for them than by having other people say that you've done a good job. And you'll want to write a good lead-in to your recommendations page, but you can add something to each recommendation that makes it more than just somebody saying that you did a great job. You'll want to add some context. As an example, so let's say that somebody writes a nice recommendation about you, but it's pretty nonspecific. Maybe they say, I was injured in a wreck, and I was so frustrated with the insurance company, et cetera, et cetera. This attorney did a great job for me. Thank you so much. By adding some extra details in the recommendation that explains the context and gives more substance to that very non-specific review. That gives it more weight and helps it to make more sense to the potential client who's going to be reading it later. An important part of writing better case results is understanding what they are meant to do, not just what they're supposed to contain. And by knowing what purpose your case results serve, you can write these very compelling stories that humanize you and really drive potential clients to reach out to you. Your case results should inspire confidence, engender trust, and convey sameness between you and your potential client, like we talked about before. Your potential clients read case results with themselves in mind, and they'll put themselves into the shoes of the clients that are the subject of your results. So that's why, more than just listing the outcome, it's very important to explain why you fought so hard and why it matters in the context of the client that you helped. Let's look at an example of how to tell a compelling story. So, the facts. Here's an example. Let's say you have a client who's in a car accident. Give your readers the setup. Maybe your client was driving down the interstate, taking their child to soccer practice, when suddenly the unthinkable happens. Describe your client's frustrations with the insurance company, with medical bills. Make the situation that your client was facing real and relatable to the person who's reading the story. What was at stake? Why is it that, as an attorney, you felt the need to take his or her case and put your energy into it? Were you fighting for that person? Were you fighting for justice? Were you fighting for both? What were the motivations of your potential client, and what were your motivations? Where do those motivations intersect? Your potential clients want to know that your motivations are in alignment with theirs. It's sort of the how much do you care part of the pyramid. Then we have the challenges, and this is where the enthusiasm comes in. What were the odds and the obstacles that you faced in this case? How did you prepare for it? And this is a matter of not only saying what you did, but how you got there. By talking just about the conclusion, which is what happens a lot of times, your potential client may not understand how much work went into the final result. As you're talking about how you prepared, talk about why you cared about the case so much, that it becomes very clear to your reader that you also care about their case. So the quest. The details here really matter, and that's regardless of what sort of case you're looking at. The details tend to go a very long way toward convincing potential clients that you are the right person for that job. A note here is that you don't necessarily want to put your bio here, but you can connect it to your client's story that ties things together nicely without necessarily restating it. You may want to include a link to your attorney bio somewhere in here. The result. So this is often where most lawyers start when they talk about success stories, but again, without understanding the facts, the challenges, the journey that you took to get to the result, potential clients may not understand this part without some context. So once you've built up those other elements, now talk about your results. But don't just talk about the legal result. Talk about how the result impacted your client's life. For example, maybe in this case, you were able to, win a case for someone who had been badly injured, and that allowed them to get the medical treatment that they needed, and so on and so forth. The deeper that you go here, the more relatable it is to your potential clients. But the end result doesn't just have to benefit your potential client. After you talk about the general results, talk about how it better armed you to serve your clients in the future. How did this case continue to prepare you for the next potential client? Your previous successes as an attorney are important points of social proof, and they can really inspire your potential clients to have confidence in your work, to engage you, to hire you. Case results, when they are written the right way, can be even more valuable than recommendations from your former clients and from your peers, from other lawyers. Unfortunately, attorneys often list case results on their law firm websites as these one or two line summaries that don't mean a lot to your potential clients and don't encourage them to reach out to you. But if you write your case results the right way, they can become powerful stories that speak to your potential clients and inspire them to seek your assistance. What we see most often on law firm websites is a single page list. A lot of results, not a lot of detail. Victories, verdict amounts, these things don't mean a whole lot to potential clients out of context. So again, when you're writing your results, think about a compelling story that encourages your potential clients to reach out to you. Okay, practice area pages. This is an area in which Rachel is going to discuss in detail, but this is where most attorney websites really begin. We do recommend going a lot deeper than just the practice area pages, but for your practice area, you want to describe it in terms that a layperson can understand. Then you want to give a simple overview of each area and then drill down into the specifics. That gives your potential clients a choice. It gives them a choice of how they want to consume that content. Do they want a basic overview of something? Maybe they want to know about something very specific about the problem that they're facing. And that leads us to detailed law pages. So this is where you're drilling down into those detailed pages. And you can spend a lot of time here and a lot of words getting more and more specific. Don't be discouraged by the idea that a potential client is only going to read a portion of what you write. You want to give them the choice as to how they want to consume that content so that if they read a basic overview and they're satisfied with what they find there, their exit is then to call you. Or maybe they keep drilling down into that content until they've read everything there is to read, and that's the point at which they decide that you're the right attorney for them. But it's important to give them that choice and to build up a really robust collection of information. And don't think that any question or topic isn't right for your website. If even one client has asked about something like that in the past, there are many more people out there who may be curious about the same thing, and they need someone who can answer that question for them. Local pages. So one of the best things attorneys can do to address people in local markets is to create pages that they can relate to. And the further that you're able to hone in on local information, the more relevant it is for those potential clients and cases that are local in nature. With Lawlytics, you can easily put in pictures and maps and so forth to easily create these pages. And the mechanics of this are a little beyond this webinar, but we do have a specific local pages webinar that you can check out. But when you create these pages and you create these silos of local pages, think about what happens in various places where you live. And Rachel's going to talk about this a little bit more in depth shortly, but you want to provide your potential clients with as much information as is useful to them. For example, what can you tell your potential clients about roads and intersections, about hospitals, medical centers, other places of business? Your competitors may not be taking the time to do this, and this kind of technique can really help you to outperform them. So, every page on your website should really address the questions that your potential clients have, but FAQ pages are special in nature in that they can do a number of different things on one page, so don't overlook the value of this kind of page. If you're sitting across the table from one of your potential clients, you know that you learn a lot about the questions that they have, their goals, their concerns, their fears. These are the same kinds of things that could go on a frequently asked questions page. A good questions and answers page helps your visibility, but it can also answer a lot of questions at the same time. You can devote an entire page or blog post to one problem, and you can link to those pages within this page, but you can also provide other questions and answers that may be of interest to your potential clients. Another thing that a good page like this can do is to help manage client expectations. So it can really help to increase productivity at your firm. When clients have questions, a good page like this can act as a resource for them. But it can also assist with expectations to prevent surprises for your firm. A good frequently asked questions page can address the questions that exist about timelines, about fees, what's expected during an office visit, and so forth. And that sort of transparency can help to manage expectations. When client expectations don't align with your service, services, that's where problems can sometimes arise. A personal injury attorney may find a potential client who expects a certain outcome because of a perception they have about how the process works, or they knew someone in a similar situation and they expect the outcome and timeline will work exactly the same for them. But an FAQ page can address even smaller issues such as how quickly your firm returns phone calls or emails, things like that. Your firm's questions and answer page can counter issues with potential clients whose expectations may be unrealistic. But every client interaction is an opportunity for you to build a really great questions and answers resource for your law firm. By addressing those perceptions and questions early on, it can comfort and educate your potential clients. It can align expectations. It can inspire potential clients too, and that's a resource that can greatly increase law firm productivity and business. So, case studies pages. It's important from a potential client's perspective to not only understand that you know about what their problem or case is and that you know how to solve it, but that you've also done things that are relevant to their case in the past, or at least that you understand it. Most potential clients don't understand nuance and legalese, but they do respond well to detailed fact patterns. So one thing that you can do is take published cases and take fact patterns from there and lay them out in individual pages and answer questions about why this happened, the procedure, and you can even make up hypothetical fact patterns and talk about how the law works in regard to those. They are going to look through those fact patterns and find things that relate to them or that resonate with them. And this is an exercise that does take a lot of time and effort, but it is well worth it, not only for your potential clients, but for search engines that are looking for this kind of relevant material to provide to potential clients who ask questions that are related to it. So, we've talked about substantive or evergreen pages, we've talked about blog posts, we've talked about reputational content, like your about pages. There is one more page I want to briefly touch upon, and that is a landing page. So landing pages are designed to bring in targeted traffic with a specific goal, and whether that goal is to contact your firm, to request a download like an ebook, to get on your subscribing list, to your email, whatever that is, this page is for that specific goal. It is designed to convert the visitor into completing whatever the user action is. Now, the benefits of building specific landing pages, which you can do in Lawlytics, is this. You convert at higher percentages, and that's because instead of casting this wide net with traditional forms of advertising where you hope to attract potential clients and you hope to attract those who are a good fit for your firm too, landing pages can narrow the scope a little bit in a way that benefits your potential client. They find exactly the sort of information that they're looking for, and it benefits your DUI firm in that you begin to build that bond of trust with them and then start building that relationship before you've ever met face to face. Landing pages are very good for removing distractions, and this is important. Now, you can have a call to action on a regular page, and that's great, but if you want to drive traffic specifically to your site to take a specific action, the best thing to do is to remove any other distractions, and a landing page accomplishes that. You also want to give your potential client specific, clear instructions, and a landing page for one specific task can do that very well. And the overall effect of this is that you can really drive down the cost of your advertising by being strategic with these landing pages. So that's all I have for my section of this webinar. I'm now going to turn it over to Rachel Shalott, and she's going to tell you some more detailed information about content. Rachel, good morning.
Thank you very much. Good morning, Tori. As Dan mentioned earlier in the presentation, I practice criminal defense in the state of Pennsylvania, and now I oversee the Lawlytics content department. We work with attorney clients to plan, create, and refine their web content. One of the first and very most helpful things you can do before creating content for a new site is to take some time and really think about the audience for whom you will be writing. Who are you attempting to target? What are the general demographic characteristics of your audience? What will be the mindset of the visitor coming to your site? a parent who's lost a child due to medical malpractice during, say, the birth process is going to be in a very different mindset than, for example, someone who's recently been charged for a DUI and searching for a criminal defense attorney. I was struck riding my bicycle during the very last week of law school, and when I was searching for a personal injury attorney, my main focus was, please, someone who can just do all of this for me and I don't have to deal with anything because my bar reclasses are starting and the worst thing that could happen is that I fail the bar exam. So keeping that in mind, keeping in mind where your audience is coming from, and then letting that guide your tone and coming to a consensus with your associates or your partners on what that's going to be and keeping that consistent as you move forward is very important. Also think about what your local language is. How do people speak? How do people refer to locations? For example, if you were searching for a dentist, would you search by your city name, by the name of a county, by the name of a township? And are there slang or colloquial terms that people might be using when seeking information online? Taking these steps early on in the process can be incredibly helpful. Drilling down on the audience you are seeking to serve will be of much greater value than attempting to find vague or general articles on SEO or just writing for the web. An unnecessary stumbling block for a new personal injury firm can often be the amount of content needed to launch. However, I really want to stress that you don't need to invest a significant amount of time or money into creating content that is necessary just to get your site off the ground. When we are working with clients who are launching a new site, we focus on what we call the structural content, and that includes the homepage, bio, and about our firm pages that Victoria spoke about earlier. Additionally, we also include a few substantive practice area pages. Generally, we plan for these pages to be a broad overview of a particular topic. We recommend that before launching, you cover each type of case that you handle on your website. This can be done in a variety of ways. If you have the time, it's an excellent idea to create distinct pages for each specific cause of action. When you're just starting out, we recommend that these pages be no longer than around 500 words on the shorter side. When covering a cause of action, you'll want to clearly define what is necessary for someone who might be bringing a potential claim, including statute of limitations and who is entitled to bring that claim. However, we sometimes see attorneys don't have the time or the resources to create a separate page for each type of case the firm handles, and that should in no way inhibit the launch of your site. What we recommend to do, if you're in this instance, is to create cluster pages, such as what is shown in the menu here. Rather than a separate page for birth injuries, surgical mistakes, and medical prescription errors, there is a cluster page titled Medical Malpractice. This page will briefly mention the types of claims a person might bring if pursuing a medical malpractice case. And these types of things can, these particular specific things such as birth injuries, surgical mistakes, can be subheadings in this page. And as Victoria mentioned earlier, we strongly recommend including an FAQ page in your initial content build. And this page can serve a multitude of purposes, including giving your site a boost with search engines as you're targeting common semantic queries, as well as giving you excellent ideas for full pages that you might want to create in the future as you're growing your online presence. Even if you're very new to personal injury, you should be thinking long term. When deciding which pages you'd initially add to your site, think of how you'll eventually want to grow your site and flesh those topics out. The reason why we start a new site with legal practice area pages that serve as a broad overview is as the website grows, we can easily add subpages that go into much greater detail. For example, to launch a site, we might include a page titled Auto Accidents, which briefly covers a variety of different types of accidents that might be experienced on the road. And on this page, motorcycle accidents, car accidents, and semi-accidents would be subheadings at the time of launch. However, As the site grows, you can use this page as a map for how you build out this section of your site, creating longer, much more in-depth pages that address each type of accident. Like I mentioned in the previous slide, starting with an FAQ page is also an excellent way to set a roadmap for future site growth and build out child pages using your FAQ as a parent page. Here in the content department, we work with attorneys who are on the Lawlytics platform, but we also work with attorneys on a variety of other platforms, including WordPress sites and, you know, working with private web developers. So if you are on a different platform, you might need to have a discussion early on in the process as far as how you're eventually going to evolve your site architecture to accommodate additional pages. However, if you're on the Lawlytics platform, you can easily add subpages to practice area pages, and it will automatically change your site architecture as you're adding new pages to what were main pages. Those pages will become child pages, and this will automatically populate in your navigation menus as well. So it keeps the site still very user-friendly. So it's pretty easy. You know, if you're on Lawlytics and you don't quite yet know exactly where you'll be going, it's easy to move forward and make those additions as you go. And the one thing I do want to caution here is if you're ready to launch a new site and you don't have time to create pages for each cause of action, we do really recommend doing a cluster technique that I spoke about earlier. Rather than creating a great deal of pages that don't contain relevant information. And what I mean by this is maybe making a page that's titled motorcycle accidents and only says something like motorcycle accidents can result in very serious injuries. We have years of experience getting compensation for motorcycle accident victims. Contact us today. Because this probably doesn't provide the information the user was attempting to obtain with that search. And it doesn't properly address that hierarchy of needs that Victoria spoke about earlier. So we've helped a great deal of personal injury firms launch their sites. So I just want to take the time now to examine some common mistakes that we've seen and stumbling blocks that attorneys can experience when they're in this phase. As I mentioned earlier, we sometimes see firms who think they need to have a site with a great deal of content in order to go live. And again, this isn't true. When adding quality content on a consistent basis definitely is crucial to having a successful long-term site. But you really shouldn't allow some notion of how large your site needs to be block you from going live. The necessary structural content in addition to those practice area pages should provide sufficient information for the time of launch. And keep in mind, this is just the beginning. You will be continuing to grow and refine your website content as time goes on. And if you're following the principle, you know, if you're doing organic marketing in that you're creating content, this is just your website and everything on it is just an asset. And that asset is going to appreciate over time. But the appreciation process, you know, really begins the day you go live. So don't let that hold you up. And so we sometimes see attorneys who do really know their audience, and they've taken the time to kind of establish some audience principles, audience guidelines. They know the local area. For example, they work in a small town, and the prevailing attitude towards lawyers is less than warm, and they know they want to come across as a guy who you'd grab a beer with after work. However, they sometimes get lost when they're creating content for their sites, and the focus sort of shifts back to legalese and more stiff, formal language. So an About Our Firm page may read something like, Mr. Faraday has years of experience litigating civil claims in Pendleton County, West Virginia, rather than Matt was born and raised right here in Seneca Rocks. After graduating from WVU, he came back to fight for the compensation his friends and neighbors rightly deserve. So it's always good to keep that in mind and keep, you know, think about as writing as you would speak. You know the client base, you know the local area, and just keep in mind, you know, write as you would speak to a client. And this might sound a little odd, but sometimes we encounter attorneys who want to include practice area pages focusing on cases that they don't actually handle. Attorneys might sometimes think that their site should have page on a topic, such as medical malpractice, even when they're not cases that the firm handles. It might be something that they're going to handle in the future, or it's something that they think having on their site will sort of lend the site an aura of expertise. So if there is an area in which you were going to bring someone on or you're going to focus on in the future, that's excellent, but don't allow yourself to be tripped up with anything that you think you need to have, you know, on the site to give it any type of, you know, an appearance or lend that credibility. Again, it's you know, really practical when you're in the start phase. You just want to be writing content around the causes of action that you'll take cases for. And then think about everything else that can go, you know, when you moved on to grow and in the future. Your time is really valuable, so you should be focusing on what will bring you the best ROI. And I know Victoria spoke at length about this earlier, but it bears repeating because we've seen it so much. We see lawyers just launching their sites who are focused not on creating content, but on, you know, knowing every single SEO trick or technique out there. And again, when you're in this position, the most critical thing you can do is focus on content and building the content. And wasting time on outdated or ineffective SEO techniques is, you know, won't do anything but hurt you. And finally, sometimes we notice some inadvertent mistakes. For example, a page written about a particular cause of action might link to a page that promotes another firm. And what I mean by that is there are many, many sites out there that consist of nothing but civil procedure for a particular state, but many are sponsored by a large firm, or they are part of a site that contains a directory of lawyers, or might even have a little Ask a Lawyer feature embedded in the page. And that's just why we always recommend sticking to government resources, such as state legislature web pages, when you need to cite to a statute. So I think the start phase is very exciting one to be in, because you're kind of taking the first step on the journey in creating a strong online presence. And when you launch a site, open a new firm, or you're offering services in a new practice area, one of the best things you can do for yourself is track as much data as you possibly can. And now right off the bat, you might not be getting a great deal of traffic with a newly launched site. However, there are many other data sets for you to track. What types of cases is your firm attracting? Do you practice in an area where you might see a spike in accidental drowning cases in the summer, but then a spike in skiing accidents in the winter? Or do you practice somewhere with a warm waterfront and you see drowning cases all year long? Things like that, just really important to keep in mind and keep an eye on as you go. And it's also a good idea to keep an eye on larger trends in your area. If commuting by bicycle has increased due to the construction of new bike lanes, might there be a spike in cycling accident claims? And that could be something you could focus on for writing for your site. And you can also gather what information might be important when creating those local pages. For example, what intersections or streets tend to have the highest rate of auto accidents in your area? Or is there a local industry that causes a particular type of problem, such as oil refineries and a high amount of truck accidents? And finally, one of the most important areas to keep tabs on are the questions that you and your staff are being asked by clients and the family members. So if you have partners and associates and or support staff, you might want to consider creating a central repository, like a shared document in a Google Drive, something that everyone can access and everyone can contribute to. Because these questions should serve as the foundation of your FAQ page so that you have all of the information that a potential client might want there on your site and can really give the guidance. And those questions can also serve as great inspiration for future pages to add to your site. So I also wanted to let you know that if you have any specific questions regarding content for your site, I really encourage you to reach out to us. You can give us a call or shoot us an email at writing@oilytics.com. Some of you might already be familiar with her, but Alyssa Rhodes is our Director of Content Services, and over the past couple of years, she's helped many attorneys launch personal injury sites. So if you have a brief question, you want some help getting started, you're interested in additional resources, or you'd like some assistance planning for the long term, we're more than happy to help. And then really quickly, I just wanted to mention what I will be covering in our next segment in the Practice Area series. Grow Your Personal Injury Practice is going to air on February 14th and then be available on demand after that date. In this webinar, I'm going to discuss some additional tools you can use for your long-term content strategy and planning, how you can flesh out those initial practice area pages that you wrote, some lessons we learned from successful growing personal injury firms, as well as some common pitfalls that you want to avoid. So if you're interested in taking that next step, please join us on Valentine's Day. And I'm now going to turn the mic back over to Victoria. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Rachel. So now that you understand how content works, there are a couple considerations you're going to have to make. The first is how often. How often will you be updating your evergreen content to include new pages? How often will you be publishing to your blog? And keep in mind that, as I discussed previously, for blogging to benefit your firm, you've got to do it consistently. Once a year, once a month, that sort of timeline won't cut it. There's some recent data from HubSpot that suggests that businesses who post more than 16 blogs in a month receive 3.5 times more traffic than those who published only up to 4 times a month. And it's reasonable to believe that that trend translates for attorneys as well. Anecdotally speaking, we see that attorneys who blog more often get more traffic. The second thing you'll have to consider is what topics you'll write about. So the best way to do this is to have a content plan. As a reminder, we have some really nice content planning resources over on our website that are free and on demand for you to view. The last question is knowing who is going to write that content. Is it going to be you or is it going to be a proxy writer? And either way, like I said before, you're going to need content. The very last thing to remember is that if you're writing your own content, perfect is really the enemy of good, or as Ali Sachs over at Iris PR said, it's not a brief, it's a blog. Don't let perfectionism get in the way of your publishing schedule. And with that, let's move from the topic of content to the topic of website design, which is another important part of your web presence. I'm now going to turn the mic over to Sophia Oluboni, who is our senior web designer. Sophia, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Victoria. How are you today?
I'm great. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you. So what I would like to do is just kind of speak upon the important basics of web design and the different elements to take into consideration when developing your law firm's website. So to start off with, design that fails to communicate is dead. That is the purpose of design, is to communicate. So interactive media adds a new element to that communication because basically it's meant to be interacted with. It's not a poster, it's not a newspaper. However, the internet is relatively a new form of media, so problems with usability always crop up when people think about the web in the same way that they've long thought about print media. Attorneys may say that they want something above the fold, as they would with like a newspaper. Or they might point out something that they want at the top of the screen, that they always want at the top of the screen. The problem with that is that web design doesn't work in terms of print rules. What is above the screen or above the fold is going to be based on what screen size or device the user is viewing the site upon. But that's hard because most of us have grown up on newspapers. And as we make the transition to new media, it's hard for people to divorce themselves from that concept. Keep in mind that when you think about web design, the rules are different now, and usability is actually the key to a good website. Next, I'm going to touch upon aesthetics. So the average user only spends just 30 seconds on a site before they move on. That's half of a minute. So it is important to have something that is visually pleasing to grab their attention. Aesthetics is known as the set of principles guiding the work of an artist. and that includes color, contrast, graphics, and layout. A website's aesthetics can influence a brand's credibility and perception. In fact, studies have shown a clear link between solid design and site credibility. Aesthetics really does have its function. Pleasant visual designs make your potential clients feel more relaxed. As a result, they tend to find a well-designed website more credible and easier to use. It's easier on the eye and considered more user-friendly than something ugly. But you also have to have something that keeps their attention once you've captured it. How you keep it is by having good content that answers a potential client's questions about their case or problem, and that's presented in a readable format. Now, readability is about featuring your content in chunks, so headlines, bullet points, the occasional bold, and having something that they can easily scan for titles and information is basically what you want. Having the content there is important. If you have a beautiful but empty website, it's going to be useless. So with the examples that I have here on the slide, if you look over to the left-hand side, you'll see the website that has the big, thick, chunky fonts that's in orange and black. And while this website is considered visually beautiful and design-wise, it is a very well-designed site, functionality-wise, it is a poor website. It is not user-friendly, it is hard to navigate, and with all of the thick, bolded font and everything taking up every inch of the screen, it is actually really impossible for the users to tell hierarchy, to be able to decipher what's more important and where the eyes should rest. So this is good design per se, but poor usability and poor user-friendliness. And to the example I have to the right, that would be what we would consider a great example of a readability. So everything is kind of chunked up and spaced out, and you have a clear hierarchy as to what is more important, which would be the business of design because it is the largest and easiest to read, and then everything else is kind of layered in order of importance of how your eye should read it. So now I'm going to touch on usability a little bit more and explain to you what that means. Now, usability is the measure of the quality of user experience when a person interacts with your site. On the web, usability is critical. It's been described as a necessary condition for survival. If your firm's website is difficult to use, potential clients will leave. If the homepage isn't clear about what you do, people will leave. If it's hard to read or it doesn't answer your client's questions, they will leave. Leaving your website is the first line of defense for users dealing with a difficult site. A usable site should be quick and easy to learn from, efficient to use, and easy to remember. The content needs to be navigable and it needs to be readable. So once again, the four main characteristics of a usable site that you should always keep in mind is that it needs to be quick and easy to learn, efficient to use, it should have rapid recovery from errors, so 404 errors, and it should be easy to remember. Some lawyers just want all of the bells and the whistles. They want a video background, they want slides with tons of movement, and they want other items that make their site just heavy and slow. It makes it harder for your potential clients to read the content on the slides or to interact with it because it is slow, and it's a waste of effort. They're going to just bounce anyways. You have to know when too much is too much and to scale back a little. Readability and usability is much more valuable than trying to have a fancy website. Studies have shown that an application's usability could influence its aesthetics, meaning the frustration a user feels on a site with poor usability will negatively influence their perception of the site's visual design. They also show that users perceive more aesthetically pleasing designs to be easier to use. What this means is that usability and aesthetics are equally important. But choosing to focus only on one over the other for your website will lead to an incomplete and unsatisfactory solution. They are two sides to the same coin, so you have to consider them equal. Now we're going to talk about focusing on what matters. You have to remember, in the grand scheme of things, you're using this website to promote yourself and your firm, so don't sweat the small stuff. The right shade of blue or the right font, if you focus too much on minor details like these, you could get in the way of you launching your site and focusing on content. Focus on what's important. Spending a week or two of your time that you could be pulling in clients going back and forth in different colors and a very similar font will not change the overall meaning or functionality of your site. And you're losing business while you're wasting time on that. At the end of the day, each color has a meaning. Blue means what blue means. The fact that you use a slightly lighter or a slightly darker shade doesn't remove the meaning of the color. The important thing is to get your site out there, to promote your firm, and to get business. Everything else is secondary. Some people argue that imagery is part of aesthetics, and while that is correct, if you're using a stock image and you're worried about the difference between an image of, let's say, downtown LA, or an LA freeway, or a professional photo of your office location, they'll each have the exact same impact as long as they are high quality images. The difference between the subject matter will not change the impact on your clients. If you spend several weeks going back and forth on these three images, it will not make much of a difference, but what will have an impact is the time that you wasted on minor details. Now I will touch up on the importance of white space. Now, white space is one of the most overlooked and underutilized parts of a good website layout. Attorneys sometimes perceive it as empty space and a waste of screen real estate, but it's a very valuable part of design. White space is a space between your columns, your text, and your images. It gives your potential clients' eyes some time to breathe. It makes people want to keep reading. When it's used well, it can really be transformative for your website design. White space increases readability for clients. It actually helps people understand what they're reading, which adds up to a better user experience overall. According to research done by the Human Factors International, white space increases reading comprehension by almost 20%. And here are some other ways that white space will benefit your website. For example, you'll have more interaction. Visitors are always in a hurry. Good white space prevents distractions that slow visitors down. It will get them to your call to action faster than bombarding them with a lot of different things to look at. And with that said, it highlights your call to actions better. A lot of attorneys think that making something bigger, bolder, or adding images to a button will draw people to it, but surrounding the item with white space would actually be much more effective. And overall, white space makes your site tidy, and tidy is impressive. Basically, white space is essential because it indicates fineness and ingenuity, and it's not bare, it's not minimal, it's not empty. When it's used correctly, it adds elegance and superiority to your site. So here's an analogy that I like to use about like tidiness. So imagine you're in a restaurant and you're sitting across from someone and you're trying to express a thought. However, the restaurant that you're in is incredibly loud and it is noisy. You have so much happening around you and it's chaotic. You'll find it hard to kind of form your thoughts and gather your words. And so having visual noise is the same thing. When your client goes onto your site and there's all these big bolded text and there's all these different colors and there's images here, there, and the other, and every bit of your white space is used up, it's noise. And it keeps them from being able to form a thought, which would be to click on your call to action or to follow through with what you want them to do. While too little white space increases confusion and decreases readability, too much white space can mean a lack of content and user guidance. And at the end of the day, it's about balance and remembering that white space is your friend. Now I'm going to touch on the concept of less is more. And this is something that's called Hicks' Law. Hick's Law basically says that the more choices we have, the longer it takes us to make a decision. And the fewer choices we have, the quicker our decision will be. Hick's Law can be applied to fine-tune the user experience. We can apply it to links, buttons, content, pages, navigation, images, and so much more. Building a great user experience can be achieved by slimming down our website and reducing user confusion and increasing your conversion rates to call to action elements. One way to achieve that is through progressive disclosure. So by holding back some of the options until they are completely necessary, you help the user maintain focus and focus on the primary set of choices while reducing the clutter and the confusion. Also, think about white space again. If you make use of white space in your design, you can direct where your users look. In this way, you can reduce the options competing for their attention. So you can have too much of a good thing, and you can easily confuse your users with too many choices. When working on the visual design of your website, you should take Hick's Law into consideration and minimize the links and the options, thus streamlining the user's decision-making process. Now, another important factor to take into consideration, especially if you're writing your own content, is the links and the links that you use on your website. Having a proper link title is a major accessibility requirement for websites. Most websites use overly general link text like click here, which says nothing about what is to be found when you do. Link text should be clear and make sense out of context. I found that instead of using non-informative phrases such as click here, read more, link to, info, or verbs in general, it's sometimes better to make a proper and concrete noun in the sentence link. So nouns can help the user quickly grasp what they're clicking without having to read the entire sentence or phrase, whereas verbs are vague and don't usually give a clear picture of what to expect. For example, as you can see on the slide that I have up, instead of writing view our firm's case results here, where here is the highlighted element, choosing something like view our case results, where the noun case results is the anchor text, is a better form of link verbiage. So poor link text will hurt your usability. Let's say you have a user who is visually impaired in some way. Maybe they use a screen reader. If so, they would have a hard time understanding vague links without having the whole page read to them word for word. In the end, the wording on a link does make a difference to the users. It's important that we make our links visually distinct from the body text and specific to the page or the document that they are linking to. Now we're going to touch a little bit more about your law firm's branding overall. Your brand is your promise to your customer. One thing I often see is that attorneys want lots of content inside of their logo. However, they fail to realize that your logo shouldn't be a sentence, a paragraph, or a phrase, but a simple visual representation. It should be easy to recognize. The goal here is to reduce the amount of content you have in your logo. More text does not scale. It's hard to read. Think about it this way. If your current logo has a lot of text in it, ask yourself, could you read this if it was printed on a pen? Could you read this quickly while you were passing a sign on the freeway? A good logo has to stand out on its own without a tagline. A tagline is something that you can highlight in other parts of your site, but it doesn't always have to be attached to your logo. There are times, though, when your tagline should be attached to your logo, but your logo has to stand on its own. It's got to represent your company even when it scales. You have to look to the future and create something that's sustainable, something that will work if you were to add partners and grow your firm. Branding needs to be consistent across all mediums. That's because consistent branding puts your potential clients at ease. Your brand helps set you apart from your competition. Another thing that I see are attorneys who love another attorney's website, and they want theirs to look just like it. Don't try to be another lawyer, and this is why. If your website looks just like another firm on the web, those potential clients are going to have to use other factors to decide which one of you they'll choose. Has that firm been around longer than you? Are they better established than you? Do they have better reviews than you? If you haven't built a strong web presence yet, mimicking something that you like too closely can be really detrimental to your business. And here's something else to think about is your domain name. A strong brand generates referrals. Think about brands separate to yourself. People love brands. People eat brands. They wear brands. And people are constantly telling other people about brands that they love. That said, you can't tell someone about a brand that you can't remember. So if your last name is hard to spell or hard to pronounce, then it's probably not the best brand name or URL name. Having something that is easily recognizable is better, and shorter is better. Now, as far as helping you define your law firm's brand, these are some questions that I find that if you ask yourself when developing that brand, it kind of helps guide you a little bit. So starting off, you want to just ask yourself, what is your firm's mission? What is your purpose? What is your drive? What are you here to do? What is the benefit for a potential client if they were to choose your firm over others? What do you do that sets you apart from all your other competitors? What do clients think about your firm? What do they, or better yet, what should they think about your firm? What are some qualities, some adjectives that they should associate with you and what you do? What qualities do potential clients associate with your brand? And that's going back to those adjectives. It's how do you stand apart? How are you different? What do you provide? So ask yourself these things as you're setting up your firm's brand, and that will kind of help guide you and help you create something that is unique and something that will stand out in a sea of competitors. Now, when it comes to developing or choosing a logo, in short, a good logo is simple. It is memorable, it is timeless, it is versatile, and it is appropriate. It's something that your potential clients will easily recognize. It features something unique without being overdone. Think about logos you know off the top of your head, like the golden arches of McDonald's, the shape of the M, the gold and the red color scheme. Coca-Cola has been timeless. It's featured roughly the same red and white logo since 1885. Your website will evolve with technology, and that's one of the things that we help you stay on top of here at Lawlytics. But your branding should be here to stay. Longevity is key. A good logo doesn't just go on your website. It may be featured on your business card, your letterhead, promotional items, pens, notebooks, cups, sponsoring banners, a booth at a convention, flyers, social media accounts. So with all these different things that it has to be able to be printed on, it has to be versatile. You have to be able to write and visually represent a lot and represent it in a lot of different ways. So you got to ask yourself, does it work when it's stacked? Does it work when it's shaded? Does it only work in one color? If that's the case, then it's not going to work. If I shrink it or if I expand it, will it look good on either size? It has to be scalable, and it has to work both in horizontal and in vertical formats. If your logo can't hold its own in black and white, it may not be the best logo as well. Here's another thing for attorneys to consider. Attorneys often gravitate towards typical legal images inside of their logos. So you'll have like the pillars, the scales of justice, the gavel, maybe a courthouse step or something to that extent. But think about all the logos that you already know about that have nothing to do with the product that they represent. And Apple is a good example. Computer logos don't have to show computers, and Apple doesn't. It's an apple, but it's iconic, and you know it anywhere. Car logos don't have to show cars. Subaru is a constellation, and Dodge is like a ram. So don't feel as if, because you are a lawyer, that your logo has to have the scales of justice or the pillars. Think outside of the box and do something more unique and something that will stand out better and will represent you better. Now we're going to move on into your tagline. Now, does your firm's tagline capture your brand? You might be able to recall the taglines of these popular brands in the images above. So, for example, M&M's, it melts in your mouth and not in your hands. For the Lay's, but you can't have just one. And for Dunkin' Donuts, America runs on Dunkin'. And what I find interesting about the Dunkin' Donuts is that even without the logo visible, just based off of the colors and the branding, like, you know that that's a Dunkin' Donuts box. So here's an example of a tagline that has always stuck with me, and I think that it's a good example. So I lived in South Florida for quite a few years, and there's a personal injury law firm whose tagline is, after 911, call 411. And they create a series of jingles using that tagline, and they print it on all billboards. That is their primary tagline. And it is short, it is catchy, it is just easy to remember, and it could also be the jingles that they use, but for some reason, whenever I hear the words 911, I immediately just repeat, call 411. So it was incredibly effective. So think of that as you're developing your brand's tagline. So now that we've touched on the importance of branding and the things to consider when developing a website or having a website developed for you, I'll go ahead and let you know what is coming up. So now that we've talked about the basics of designs and considerations in February, we'll dig deeper into the elements of design that can have a psychological effect on your potential clients and encourage them to engage with you. We'll discuss using the right kinds of typeface, what colors mean, what they can say about your firm, the various shapes of logos, and how that can affect a potential client's perception of your firm, as well as examples of how to make your content readable using parenting child stacking of your content and so much more. So with that, I'm going to turn the mic back over to Dan.
Thank you, Sophia. Well, we are almost 70 slides into this webinar, and in 2 hours and 15 minutes in, we've gone over a lot of information. If you're just now getting started, or if you're trying to figure out how to reboot your firm's personal injury marketing and make it work again, the good news is that you don't need to remember all the details that we went over today or implement them all at once. The important thing is to get started on the fundamentals. If you're wondering where to start, we can help. And if you're already well on your way, next month's personal injury webinar in the Grow series will provide you with actionable items that are easy to implement and over time can significantly and sustainably move the needle and produce revenue for your practice. Before we go to questions and answers and end the webinar, I want to mention that yesterday we did a webinar on online reputation management for lawyers, which is an especially important topic for personal injury lawyers. I want to let you know that it is now available to watch in replay format on the webinars pages, webinars page rather, of the Lawlytics website. So go to lawlytics.com/webinars. And towards about halfway down the page, there's legal marketing topics, and it's right at the top of that cluster of webinars that you can go to and watch it at your convenience. We also have other practice areas in this Start, Grow, and Dominate series that we're doing. We did DUI last week. We did criminal defense earlier this week. And we've got a few other topics coming up throughout the rest of this month. So if you have other practice types in your firm, either other people that are practicing those areas or other areas that you practice or want to practice yourself, might be worthwhile to check those out as well. I want to thank Sophia, Rachel, and Victoria for your presentations, and thank you all for attending this webinar. I hope it helped, and I hope to see you again soon. And with that, Tori, let's go to the next slide, and we can take a look and see if we have any questions here. We're going to go ahead and end this recording.